Next thing I want to get into is desecration. I want you to turn, if you would, to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. There's a very interesting little tidbit there that many people kind of just fly right over when they're doing their Bible through the ear again or something. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, this is written about AD 60, 60 years, Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. That's what AD means, BC, before Christ. Of course, they can't even let that stuff. They got to go back and revise history. They got to go back and change everything. So they don't call it BC anymore. They got some other term for it, and they don't call it AD because it's connected to Jesus, Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. And we don't want that, you know. What, yeah, it's these other terms and stuff like that, which is nonsense. But anyway, this is about AD 60 when this was written. The last amen of the book of Revelation had not yet been recorded when corruption of the biblical text at the hands of heretics began. The heretics are people that teach false doctrines, doctrines that don't line up with the Bible. And in 2 Corinthians, you're warned of this in chapter 2, verse 17. Paul says, it's him talking, "For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God." Him and the guys traveling with him are not of the group of many people that corrupt and change what God said. There, in his day, there were already many people corrupting what God said. Again, they had to do stuff by hand, you know. I mean, they had to copy things by hand. They didn't have printing presses and all that stuff. You don't get that till Johannes Gutenberg and all that, but where you could start making books, mass producing them and stuff. So they had these manuscripts that I covered last time and how meticulous they were to do it, but there was people in the business and corrupting and changing on purpose. And so you're warned in the Bible. Paul said, "We are not as many which corrupt the word of God. But as of sincerity, but as of God, in the sight of God, speak we in Christ." And so there were many people even in his day that were corrupting what God said. And so there's ample warning right there in the Bible. Another couple things we're going to cover, of course, what I mentioned last week. When Satan first tempted Eve in the garden, immediately doubted, caused her to doubt what God said. We covered that last week. His first recorded words to humans, "Yea, hath God said." And so the ultimate goal of textual corruption is to put a question mark over the Word of God. From Genesis 3, verses 1 to 5, it appears in many forms. Doubting God's Word. "Yea, hath God said?" There's the devil doubting. Diluting God's Word. "Well, we may eat." Distending or enlarging on God's Word. "Neither shall you touch it." They were never told they couldn't touch the tree.
Yeah.
That's her adding some extra commands to the thing. That's enlarging. Most people don't realize the first revision of God's word was the Eve Revised Standard Version that she just put out there. But anyway, she had added to what God had said. You never said you couldn't touch it. Diminishing God's word, lest you die. Denying God's word in verse 4, "Ye shall not surely die." That's the devil immediately taking a diametrically opposed position. He approaches you on a positive note.
Yeah.
But putting some doubt in your mind about what God said, and then flat out says, "You're not going to die." Well, God said you would. And see, the problem with that, I don't have time to teach that, but the problem of that thing, when you get over there, it looks like when that whole thing is done, and they follow him and listen to him, and he becomes their new master, and they're following him, not what God said, and they go ahead and take and eat. He said, "See? I told you. Come on, high fives all around. You're not going to die." Looks like you won, huh? Wrong. They died that very day.
That's right.
Man is three parts. Peter mentions in the New Testament, "I pray your whole body, soul, and spirit be presented blameless unto the coming of our Lord." Body, soul, spirit.
Yep.
They died that day. It's dead spirit.
Yep.
No more immediate contact. And before, I mean, they had a direct, you know, I'm dating myself, but back when I was a kid in school, you know, the bat phone, Batman was on TV, you know, the bat phone, so it's a direct line. Military used them too, direct line. You know, boom, you pick it up, you ring the thing, boy, and it goes right straight to hit command post or whatever. You pick it up, it's a direct line. They had a direct line to God before. When they died right there. And because their outward flesh didn't die, and he said that you won't die, he appears like an illusionist. "I told you, you wouldn't die." So he looks like he told the truth, but of course he didn't. Displacing God's words. Verse 5, "Ye shall be as gods." See, God's keeping stuff back from you. You know, he's kind of a mean guy, and he's all kinds of good stuff he doesn't want you to mess around with. He doesn't want you to share any of the good stuff with you or whatever. So he always paints God to look like he's the bad guy. All the while, he's the bad guy. I won't use a modern example of that, because we have plenty of modern examples of that type of stuff, where someone who's a certain way says the other people are that way, but then they prove who was really that way. So in Colossians 2:8, you're warned again. In the book of Colossians, if you'd flip over there, again, Bible tabs are always a nice thing. The book of Colossians, chapter 2, verse 8, beware lest any man... So beware of men, because, you know, they can get you. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy. Some of the greatest philosophers on the planet, Socrates and Philo and all those guys. Beware of philosophy and vain deceit. Now, deceit is trickery. Vain is worthless. Worthless trickery. I mean, it's deceit that has its ultimate... They're basically trying to make merchandise of you, usually. Trying to sell you their new self-help book or the new philosophical book that explains, you know, how to be more happy in your marriage or whatever. All this different stuff that's out there. How to be more happy in your marriage is in the Bible.
Amen.
Okay? The answers to all life questions are in the Bible, but, you know, there's no end to the making of books. That's a Bible verse that you don't hear on the Christian radio, but there's no end to the making of books. And so there's all these different kinds of books and self-help books and all this other philosophical stuff that's out there. But you're said, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the traditions of men. That's a great study when you start talking cults and different things or different denominations. The study of traditions. Traditions, I forget how many times it's in the Bible. I wasn't prepared to say this, but you know, you type it up in a Bible program, boom, it's going to pop up X number of times. All of them are bad, except one.
Yeah.
Follow the traditions that we've taught you about God's Word, the apostle says in one spot. I'm paraphrasing there a little bit. But all the rest are bad. Man just following man's tradition. Well, we always did it this way. Well, this is the way we always did it. Those are spoken of against in the Bible, the traditions of men, over and over and over and over again. So after the rudiments of the world, those traditions of men are after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ and what he said. So they go in direct contradiction to Christ in the Bible. And so you have these warnings in the Bible. History shows, well, for example, philosophy subtracts from the words of God, and tradition adds to the words of God, additional things you need to do and all this other stuff. In fact, they were teaching in the New Testament. They had a kind of a dispute. These people were teaching that you also had to get circumcised. You know, you had to be, you know, born again, get saved, trust Jesus as your Savior and all that, and then you had to get circumcised. You just had to. And so they bring that up to the council and all this other stuff, and they said no. They cleared that whole thing up and said, you don't have to do that. The things you need to do that was given before the law, in the Old Testament, before the law, you don't eat blood. Under the law, Exodus chapter 20, Deuteronomy chapter 5, the two places the Ten Commandments are listed, under the law, you don't eat blood. New Testament, you don't eat blood. I had to teach that in the Philippines. When I went to my wife's island in the Philippines, guess what? Blood pudding and blood sausage and blood, all kinds of stuff, right? And then people eating it. Well, I mean, it's just lack of knowledge through ignorance. I mean, they're not evil or mean people or whatever. No, they're perfectly fine or whatever, but they just didn't know. They didn't know that before the law, you're not supposed to eat blood. Under the law, Old Testament and all that, no blood. In the New Testament, command to abstain from fornications, things offered to idols, and from blood. New Testament. And you don't have to be circumcised to get to heaven or whatever. That was just typology that was picturing the Holy Spirit coming inside us in the book of Colossians and cutting our flesh off of our soul. Anyway, I don't have time to teach all that, but that was, you know, it's not required to get circumcised. It wasn't required to be baptized. Otherwise, a poor thief on the cross, both of them died and went to hell. You have Jesus lying again. If that's the position, that's not the position. I tell you the truth, today you'll be with me in paradise. Yeah. Church of Christ, who are huge in Texas, for example, you can't drive into a Texas town without seeing a little sign, Church of Christ over on 2nd Street. Church of Christ is huge through certain places in the South. They teach salvation by baptism. That's how they say it. Whenever you mess with God's word, he seems to mess with your mouth. You know. Anyway, baptism. They believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It's baptism. But they teach salvation by baptism. There's no salvation in the water. Otherwise, the thief on the cross didn't get it, get baptized. So it doesn't save you. It just identifies. It's like putting a uniform. You're on our team. We're going to be in our softball league or whatever it is. Well, come on. Here's our uniform. Put a uniform on. You can be on our team. Any good? You know, it's the thing that identifies the Christian as following Christ. Because how do we know that you're saved? Only you and God know you're saved. You don't know me from Adam and I. You know, some of you I may have seen before. I saw you obviously last week and stuff. But, I mean, I don't know you. You don't know all about me or whatever. So the one thing that shows people that you're on his team, the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, which is why baptism is done that way and not sprinkling and traditions of men, sprinkling and whatever, pouring. You can't find the Bible anywhere. You sprinkled the blood on the mercy seat. You poured out the offering, but baptism was always by in deep water by immersion because it pictures the death, burial. We are buried together with him by baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. Romans, what is it, chapter 5. So you clear those things up from the Bible. Editorial corrections. By far, the greatest corruptions came via the pen of scribes who acted as editors rather than copyists. And the wicked thing, I mean, this stuff is important, folks, because it has a direct bearing to today in public schools, where all of a sudden the history of different events, all of a sudden, no, it didn't work that way, it didn't happen that way, it happened this new way. It's called revisionist history, where they go back and write that you can't, history happened. I mean, there's people seen it, eyewitness accounts. Fox's Book of Martyrs is eyewitness accounts of people that stood there at the stake and watched those Christians burn and sang and preached. God gave them unbelievable grace.
Yeah.
In fact, one of those, I love the martyrs, man. I could focus just on that. I love them to death. Those guys gave us our Bibles. They suffered and paid the ultimate price. There was one time that they were scared and they were in prison and looking out the doors at Smithfield and Bloody Mary, the Queen, Catholic Queen Bloody Mary, was burning martyrs at the stakes for having a Bible, for quoting a Bible, for teaching their kids the Bible in English and all that stuff. And she got on the throne, boy, and she was, that's why she called Bloody Mary. She was a killer big time. But she did it like Hitler. You know, she just gave the command and someone else, you know, did the burning or whatever. But they were sitting there in the looking out at that field and they'd see martyrs go out there and get burned. And they knew they were next. And I forget the guy, but they looked at him and said, well, is there some way you've got to, when they take you out there, just somehow let us know that God is there in the fire with you. Could you somehow let us know? So he said, well, if the Lord allows me or whatever, I'll do my best, you know, I just don't want to fail Christ and, you know, all that. And so, you know, that next morning, boy, they came for him. And I forget his name, it's in the book. And they take him off and they cart him down there to Smithfield and they're looking out the windows at that burning boy, you know, those prison windows. Remember in the basements back, I'm from back east, we had basements. They had these little dinky windows that would kind of open like that. Sitting there in the dungeon down the bottom looking out the window, you know, and looking over there at Smithfield. And they're getting the fire ready for this guy and they tie him to the stake. With cords or whatever. And like I told you, if they liked you, they'd put dry wood. If they hated you, detested you, they'd put green wood and cook you. I think it was this guy, they put dry wood and they light the, of course, they always give you a chance to recant. They always give you a church to come back to the mother church. Come back to the Holy Roman Empire. Come back to the mother church, the Holy Roman. But he wouldn't. And so they went ahead and lit the fires. And he was standing there and his head slumped down like that, and he's tied to this pole, and he's laying there like that, and he's burning, and the people down in the dungeon looking out, going, oh God, we're next, it's gonna be, oh God, please help him, give him strength, give him grace. Then all of a sudden, the fire had burned through the leather thongs or tongs or leather laces or whatever that they tied him up to the post, and all of a sudden, he raised his hands. His hands were on fire. He raised his hands above his head. Boom! And his fingers went flying. He clapped his hands three times over his head. That God's grace was sufficient to get him through the fire. They asked for a sign that God would help you. Where's that in the Bible? Where's that in the Bible that God would get you through the fire? You thank you, brother.
Yep.
It's in Daniel. But you got to have a King James Bible. Otherwise, you have, did not we toss three men into the fire, and yet I see four, said the king. And the fourth is like a son, small s, of the gods.
Yep.
No. Modern Bible's junk. That fourth is like the Son of God, capital S, capital G. Not small s, small g, plural, Son of the gods. That's what the modern Bibles will tell you.
Yep.
You can check them yourself. Daniel, whatever chapter that is. The fourth is like the Son of God. Jesus was in the fire with them.
That's right.
He was in the fire with them folks. Those are eyewitness accounts.
Amen.
Of people that were there and seen it. You can't teach a King James without teaching something about the martyrs. There's interchangeable, I mean intertwined. There's no way you could teach one without the other. In fact, my brother Reyes asked me, hey, could you come down and do King James? Two Wednesdays. I says, yeah, but I said, can I do it in two parts? Because I mean, I'll be jipping half the story, you know, like Paul Harvey. Remember Paul Harvey? And the rest of the story, he used to be a radio guy. But I mean, they're only going to get a part of the story unless I tell them the stuff about the martyrs that got them to the place where they could have a King James Bible. So I mean, to me, both sides of the same coin. I mean, you can't have one without the other. So they made changes in church discipline, changes in church worship, all kinds of changes in church ordinances. There's two ordinances in the Bible. It's baptism, going into all the world, preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, and the Lord's Supper, Lord's Table, communion, is the other ordinance in the church. So then the man, you know, wanted new traditions, started making new things, and other additional things, and some other stuff you could do. And beware of men's traditions. They don't line up with the Bible. So the great center of textual corruption was down in Alexandria, Egypt. Egypt always in the Bible is a type of the world. When Abram, you know, there was going to be a famine coming and all that, rather than trust God that God would feed him and care for his family, he went down.
Yeah, come on.
Down. We're at work, you know, and you know, I remember years back, you know, from Los Alamos, we're at work, and somebody says, yeah, we're going to be taking a cruise. We're going down to Alaska. Dude, Alaska's up. So I'm real big on that up and down and right and left and east and west and all that. I mean, you'll hear people say that sometimes. You know, hey, we're going up to Albuquerque this weekend. Well, that's fine for you folks, but it wasn't for the folks in Los Alamos, because we're going down to Albuquerque this weekend. We're coming down from, you know, 7,200 feet. We're going to come down to around 5,000 feet. We're going down to Albuquerque. The reason I say that is because God is real clear about that. He doesn't make those kind of mistakes that men make when they speak and say things. When they went down into Egypt, they were trusting the world to feed them, and Pharaoh and the big kingdom and all that stuff that they had there. They weren't trusting God. And so it didn't go well. He had to start lying and, you know, well, just tell them, you know, boy, she's fair to look. Sarai was fair to look upon. And, you know, think, man, they're going to kill me and take you to wife and all that. Just tell them you're my sister. Now, it was a half-truth and half-lie kind of thing. But going down into Egypt. So it's pretty peculiar that when Joseph and Mary have this baby, they're warned by an angel to go down into Egypt because someone is seeking his life. And of course, Herod, the wise men come. Where is he that's born king of the Jews? And they're, pardon me, excuse me. I'm King Herod. Now you're asking for who? He that's born king of the Jews. Another king? Very shrewd, just like his master. Very subtle. Well, we have seen a star in the east. Do we come forth to worship him? Oh, okay. Well, I'll tell you what. If you guys can help me out, when you find him, you let me know, because I want to come worship him too. And do the old Grinch smile right there.
Yeah.
Where it kind of curls up on the end. A fake smile, you know, like a politician. And that was, they're trying to get him. So God hit him down there. Went to Egypt just for a while, and until Herod died, and Herod gave this great speech. They said, man, he speaks like a god, not even men. Because he didn't give God the glory, boom, God smote him. There's a number of Herods. Well, there's 5 or 6 or 7 Herods. There's like 5 Marys, I think 7 Herods. I may got the wrong Herod there. But anyway, there's a bunch of different Herods. Very popular. Mikes, there's a lot of Mikes back in the 60s. That was the number one male name back then, so there's a lot of those floating around too. But a lot of Marys in the Bible, a lot of Herods. But anyway, once the person who's trying to kill Jesus, King Herod, is dead, go back and, you know, you can go up there. The person who sought his life is gone. So they go back up. The reason Jesus went down there was so that he could be called out of there.
Yeah. True.
To perfectly type. Because God's into this. There's nothing new under the sun, guys. When there's a new book or a new movie or coming attractions, this is in the future. Look at, you know, da 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 da. You know, this is coming. God's been doing that for thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of years. People eating manna, that'll come again. He would one day call all his people out of the world. A church is ecclesia, a called out assembly. Your folks are meeting here today. You know, we all work and have jobs or do whatever, you know, right? We're in the world, we work in the world, be in the world but not of the world. We come out. One day Jesus Christ will call us completely out. And the reason he'll do that is because he did it before. His son went down into Egypt and was called out of Egypt. The same way we that follow Christ are called out of the world. Be ye separate. Touch not the unclean, and I will receive you unto myself, saith the Lord. He's called us out of the world. And so he does those different things. So the corruption, the stuff that gets in the Bible, they start tampering with stuff. And the place that they tampered with the stuff was in Alexandria, Egypt. Not the right place. It was down in Alexandria. I don't have time to get into the Tale of Two Cities. But the good manuscripts that make up well now over 5,000, I've looked up the number lately, but well over 5,000, 5,400 or so. Actually, I think it's 5,700. Biblical manuscripts, pieces, parts of the Greek New Testament. Sometimes it's an entire book, sometimes it's three or four books, sometimes it's just a part of a chapter or a sentence or two or whatever, but there's all these pieces and parts that they find. They find usually a couple a year. Those things all agree with each other, and we're centered around, I'm simplifying this, but we're centered around, it's called the Byzantine text, Assyrian text. They're centered around Antioch, in that area there. And that's where the good manuscripts came from. That's where the good trustworthy Bibles came from. Origen, who castrated himself and walked around with a team of scribes barefoot, he was the one that went to the Bible, and as he read it, he saw problems with it. You know, Solomon had this many chariots, and it said he had this many horses, but the horses and the stables don't match, the numbers aren't exact, so he went in and changed the numbers so that it looked like when you tell the story, everything would match up. He's trying to help God out, you know. And so he went through and started editorializing and making editorial changes into the text. He did this around 180 to 2, was it 234 or whatever he lived there. And that's the time frame he did that. It was his manuscripts that are believed to be, Sinaiticus is believed to be his writing, the Sinaiticus manuscript that they found in the garbage can. And so I'm going to touch on these briefly. The good pieces came from the Antioch area. Sinaiticus and Vaticanus. Sinaiticus is known as Elf, kind of has like a little label to it, or they label a lot of, I mean, there's hundreds and hundreds of thousands of these parchments and pieces, and so they label them P33, P56, parchment, you know, 56 or whatever. They name all these little pieces. Many of them, like some of them are in the Leningrad Museum in Leningrad, Russia, St. Petersburg. Some of them are in Philadelphia, in the college, university there. So there's bits and pieces of these things all over the world, and of course they share them and photographs of them and with other universities and all that, and museums and all that stuff. So Sinaiticus and Vaticanus are the two that have corrupted all these Bibles right here.
That's right.
These men, the root of the corruption was men tampering with what God said. And Origen is the guy who did that. Let me give you, I mentioned some things about him. I don't know if, Origen of Alexandria, the author of Sinaiticus and the Hexapla. Hexapla is a six-column Bible. And it was that corrupted fifth column, the bad fifth. Fifth is the number of death in the Bible. That fifth column was corrupted. There's some military things that are connected to that, a lot of different things, but the fifth is no good. But anyway, the fifth column, the Hexapla, he castrated himself, walked barefoot with a team of scribes, with him to rewrite biblical manuscripts. Here are his beliefs and comments. Now, this is what he believed. We got this from his writings. Origen had so surrounded himself to the fervor of turning all Bible events into allegories, like stories. You know, remember we talked about rewriting history? The Bible said this, but that's not really what it means. What it means is, yeah, it says that, but there's a deeper meaning to it. It means this. So you don't take what it says, you take what he says it means. And so everything was allegorical. And so that was his whole method of interpreting the Bible. He was a mess. He said, quote, "The scriptures are of little use to those who understand them as they're written." Scriptures are of little use? I mean, what are you even saying that for? "In order to estimate Origen rightly, we must remember that as a pupil of Clement," that's who he studied under Clement, "he learned the teachings of the Gnostic heresies like his master, lightly esteemed the historical basis of the Bible." As Schaff, Philip Schaff, says, quote, he was really connected to and loved the writings of Plato, who you were warned about philosophy, right, in the Bible? He was a pagan philosopher that led him to many grand and fanciful errors. He made himself acquainted with various heresies and studied under the heathen Ammonus Saccas, founder of Platonism, or whatever, the following of New Plato, basically, is what it is. Origen taught that the soul existed from eternity before it inhabited the body. After death, it migrated to a higher or lower form of life according to the deeds done in the body. See, there's a little bit of Hindu, a little bit of New Age, a little bit of what's her name, caught up in a tree. Well, that one lady, red hair. was real popular around the time of Johnny Carson and all that. He used to have her on all the time. What was her name? Real friendly with, what's her name? The one that was over in Vietnam behind the guns with the 50 cal guns and was giving the names of the stuff to the troops. She was, what's her name? Driving me nuts. But anyway, she taught, she was heavily followed and had a crazy belief system. And Shirley MacLaine, thank you, brother. Shirley MacLaine, the other one I'm talking about was Ted Turner's wife. He got rid of her after she got saved. She got saved. That's why that marriage broke up between Ted Turner and, what's her name? Jane Fonda, the traitor and all that. But yeah, real popular back then. But anyway, let me give you what he believes here. So yeah, the whole thing about you come back, reincarnation. Shirley MacLaine taught reincarnation. Well, this guy believed it. You want somebody like that writing manuscripts that make all modern Bibles?
Come on.
I mean, this guy's a mess. See, it does matter who your friends are. I'm trying to, I'll be on my best behavior not to be political. But it does matter who your friends are. I'm telling you, boy, it matters an awful lot when they send $1.8 billion to Iran. Yeah. It matters who your friends are. Valerie Jarrett. But anyway, it does matter who your friends are. I was good with him right up until that point. I really was, but that was treasonous. Anyway, because they're our enemy, they're trying to kill our whole country. But Origen, he taught these crazy things. He believed that the devils would be saved. That's what the Universal Church teaches. The Universal Church allows the Wiccans, the witches, to meet on their property at their church in Los Alamos. And they also had a Wiccan coven meeting on church property, which is why I pulled my son out of public school in Los Alamos. That was the event that made me remove my son. So he taught a lot of crazy stuff, believed a lot of crazy stuff. Believed that every one of us would return to a state of pure intelligence. Does that sound like Star Trek or something or what? Only to begin the same cycle as before. He believed that the devils would be saved, that the stars and the planets had souls. What Bible's he getting that out of?
Yeah, come on.
And were like men on trial to learn perfection. In fact, he turned the whole law and the gospels into an allegory. Orange flooded the Roman Catholic Church through Jerome, the father of Latin Christianity. I love the name of Origen, said Jerome, the most distinguished theologian in the Roman Catholic Church since 1850. I will not listen to a notion that so great a soul was lost. So the folks that followed and taught theology there loved this guy to death and wouldn't hear that he was a bad guy or he had some crazy beliefs. There's more than that. But so he was tampering with the texts of the Bible. I wanted to get into Sinaiticus and Vaticanus. So these manuscripts, I'll give them to you now. Sinaiticus manuscript, known as Alf, was Origen's work of changing the manuscripts. It was found in a trash can in 1859 by Count Tischendorf in St. Catherine's Monastery, which is located at the foot of Mount Sinai. It shows the marks of 10 correctors after him. There's 10 people hacking all over that document. And again, this is available online. You can look at that document. Every single leaf is, there's a bunch of leaves. There's 447 and a half leaves of vellum, which is unborn animal skin. Very costly because you got to kill the mom and get the baby, and it's such a fine leather, you know, I mean. 147 leaves of vellum, 4 columns, 48 lines. It's 15 inches by 13 and a half in size, and it's all available online for you to see. You just go look it up. But it had the marks of 10 correctors making changes all over it. Don't forget that the modern Bibles, including the Schofield I have here in the notes, tell you that the oldest and best manuscripts don't have that verse there.
That's right.
Sinaiticus and Vaticanus don't contain that. That's the oldest and best? It may be pretty old, but it's certainly not the best when there's 10 people hacking all over it. How does that all of a sudden become best? But that's what they say, right in your Bible, in the text of your Bible. Down in the notes are from men, the text is the Bible, but the notes are from men. So it also was written in the classical literary style and not in the Koine Greek style. See, the New Testament was written in Koine Greek, which is common Greek. It's not written in common Greek. Well, how can this match? Remember those tests we talked about? The author and the style and the acceptance, and is it, you have God's authority on it and all that? It's not even written in the same, it's not even the same kind of writing. Different style of writing completely. One of the apocryphal books, now these are the hidden, apocrypha means hidden things. These are the hidden books that come out of basically the 400 silent years between the Old and New Testament when God didn't say anything. And that's where, when God wasn't saying anything, guess what man decided to do?
Yeah.
you know, they started writing all kinds of stuff. You get some crazy stuff. A lot of those crazy books, like The Shepherd of Hermes. You know what Hermes means? Devil. Shepherd of Hermes is in Sinaiticus. Isn't that a nice little thing to just add in there? One of the apocryphal books, The Shepherd of Hermes, gives clear instruction from a female angel. There are no female angels in the Bible. None. So probably we're guessing, you know, probably a demon or a devil or something. It tells you to give in to the beast and bear the mark. Why would you get, I quoted the Grinch earlier, Christmas time's coming, I wouldn't touch him with a 39 and a half foot pole. Why would you get anywhere near that? That's a biblical text? That's going to fix our Bibles? Are you kidding me? What a mess! Oldest and best manuscripts, huh? Someone hasn't done their homework. You can check us on this stuff. Vaticanus, I told you about the Vaticanus manuscript, is believed to be one of 50 copies written by Eusebius in order of the Roman Empire, Constantine. Now Constantine, see what happened was Constantine was a conqueror. He was a king, like an emperor. But there was something that he was lacking. You know, they say power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And so he had control over, he's like the new president or whatever, he had control over something, he had control over the country. And he's like, wait a minute, but this church has got control over the hearts of men. It's got control of their money. I mean, they give money to the organization. Boy, if I could get that too, I would have the political power and then I would have the religious power. So Constantine, in 313, 13 is a number of rebellion, but anyway, in 313, Constantine married the Catholic Church together with the government. That's where that happens at. And so, Vaticanus document itself, that manuscript is believed to be one of the 50 copies written out to be used in churches in Constantinople. It is written in book, which means it's a codex. Codex is a term for a book. It's written in book form on vellum, which is tanned unborn animal skins, and was in excellent condition. Excellent. Due to, obviously, disuse. They weren't using it. Remember we talked about the acceptance of the people in... They weren't using it, so it was in beautiful condition. It was found on the shelf in the Vatican Library in 1481, just tucked away. It omits Genesis 1:1 all the way through to chapter 46 from the book of Genesis, taken out. It removes Psalm 106 all the way to Psalm 138. Well, wait a minute, pray tell, isn't there an important chapter in Psalm about 119 or so that talks about the largest chapter in the entire Bible, speaks about the Bible? That's been taken out. Matthew 16, 2-3, all of 1 Timothy is gone. 2 Timothy, gone. Titus, gone. Hebrews 9, 14-13, 25, gone. The whole book of Revelation, gone. Not included at all. The text shows scribal carelessness. It exhibits numerous places where the same word or phrase is written twice in succession, and they have a fancy theological name for that that I won't bore you with. But they, you were left off here and had to go to the bathroom or something, come back and pick your pen up and write the same thing you just wrote, and then keep going. And then someone goes back through and says, "And the cow jumped over the moon." I mean, what's that thing there twice for? We joke about that because that guy I work with, he said these big old military reports and stuff like that. He had one of the guys on shift one time, big old report that he had to turn into the colonel, general, or something like that. And right in the middle of the report, "And the cow jumped over the moon." What did he put that in there for? Well, he found out. Front and center. My office tomorrow morning. "Yes, sir." You know, well, he read the report. The guy just wanted to know, "Man, has anybody ever read this stuff?" "And the cow jumped over the moon." Anyway, yes, they did read it. The guy got in trouble. Never did that again. So again, on this map, I'm giving you the details of these two manuscripts because these are the manuscripts that are used by Westcott and Hort to make a Greek Old Testament and New Testament that are the foundation of all modern Bibles. So the text shows scribal carelessness. I told you that. This manuscript differs. This manuscript, Vaticanus, differs from Sinaiticus some 3,036 times in the four Gospels alone. They don't even agree. Remember we talked about when, you know, the authority, and was a guy an apostle or a prophet, and did it, does it even agree with the rest of the Bible? Like I mentioned, when I mentioned I started studying one of these other books, these spurious books, I'm like, this, the Bible is eating the lunch. I mean, as I'm reading this, verses are jumping in my head. Don't agree with that. I'm reading down through there. What? Do you tell me to drink and all this stuff? Woe unto him that giveth his neighbor to drink, the Bible says. I mean, but yet in that book, you know, they were promoting drinking. I wonder why they do that. Because they give them, you know, the mass.
Yeah.
And, you know, those guys used to get pretty wasted. So anyway, you can tell it doesn't jive with the rest of the Bible. So it didn't jive with Sinaiticus in 3,036 times in the Gospels alone. It contains 7 apocryphal books in the Old Testament, 7 of them. It also has scribal changes written over it from the 10th century, where someone in the 10th century thought, well, that's not right, and started making changes to it. Oldest and best, right? It also is written in the classical literary Greek rather than the Koine Greek. It's not written in the same Greek as the whole New Testament is. I mean, you know, boop, boop, boop. I mean, these little, you know, warning lights, you know, nobody would ring. Warning, Will Rogers. Anyway, it's an old TV show from the 50s. But warning, Bill Robinson, warning, warning, danger, danger. But anyway, so, okay, one person got it. So anyway, but there's warning lights in there. There's warning verses. There's warning things that should have cued you in. Man, this, how can this be Bible? This isn't Bible. When it doesn't agree with the Bible. So it's in the wrong language, it's in the wrong Greek. It's classical Greek. It also has scribal changes, I mentioned that. It's 759 pages, 10-inch by 10.5-inch, in 3 columns, about 41 lines per column. The manuscript was available during the translation. It was available during the translation of the Authorized Version of 1611. Erasmus even referred to it in 1515. Desiderius Erasmus, we had a whole thing on him. I hope you read that thing. Desiderius Erasmus was a genius. And he ignored it. He referenced it, knew it was out there, mentioned it, and ignored it and didn't use it. Pretty smart guy. So there's some information on that. There's a whole lot more than that. But that'll give you a taste of these 2 manuscripts that were used and the contamination and desecration of God's texts that was used and filtered through. It filtered on down through. You end up with the work of Westcott and Hort, who relied heavily. They gave preference. Westcott and Hort gave preference to whatever Sinaiticus or Vaticanus said. Unless, of course, they didn't even agree themselves. Well, then what did they do? Well, they bumped God off the throne, sat up there, and made the choice themselves. See, that's always the point, is the final authority. I brought that book last week, never did pull it out, but it'd be a good time to show it right now. Final Authority by William Grady. It's always a matter of final authority.
Yep.
Who's the final authority? Is it going to be God in your life, or is it going to be you? Because if the final authority in all matters of faith and practice becomes you, guess who you have just become?
That's right.
Come on. I guess we need to bow down and worship you. We have, if we do that, honestly, I'm not trying to be mean or whatever, but if we do that, if God's not the final authority in all matters of faith and practice, then who is? So the issue of final authority, and that's a great book too by William Grady, Final Authority. I had it here last week, but it was down under here. It wasn't on the table, but I didn't bring all those books back, so I was planning on bringing a few more. But so that's how messed up. I wanted to give you, I think I had one other place here I wanted to give you, where they talk about, those 2 manuscripts. Thought I had it marked. Yeah. I'll close her down here. I'll definitely stop on time. I should have marked them in here first, but anyway. Both Westcott and Hort put Vaticanus and Sinaiticus manuscripts as the premium. If the 5,400 Greek New Testament pieces back then was about 5,300 back in their day, if those pieces all agreeing together say this, and either Sinaiticus or Vaticanus say something different, we'll stick with that. We're going to stick with that because it's the oldest and best. They just stuck with that sales pitch. It's the oldest and best. It's the oldest and best. Well, wait a minute. It's not even the best. We already talked about that. I mean, it's a mess. The thing's not clean. It's not pure. When they found that complete book of Isaiah in the Dead Sea Scrolls, that thing was pristine, folks. It was beautiful. All the words were there, none of them missing. It exactly matched from 800 years earlier, it exactly matched the oldest Isaiah scroll we had today. Exactly. Now that's what an oldest and best looks like.
Yeah.
It doesn't look like 10 guys hacking all over it.
Amen.
And using rescriptus. Rescriptus is a term where you scratch off that ink and then you rescript, or you script over and rewrite over that spot. It didn't have marks of rescriptus in it or any of those other telltale marks of it being tampered with. So I wanted to give you some little light clue on how that was that took place, and the key players were those two manuscripts, and the key players were Westcott and Hoare. The stuff that I covered, I did cover a little bit of that last week. These guys were into ghostly guilds and seances and all that stuff. In college, they started a group, the Ghostly Guild, and they were practicing. That's forbidden in the Bible to mess with any of that stuff.
Amen.
And yet these Anglican priests, who didn't spend any time really being a priest, they were Anglican scholars, are messing around with seances and getting in touch with devils and demons and everything else. These two guys were. And Dr. Gipp owns those two books, The Life and Letters of John Fenton Anthony Hoare and Brooke Foss Westcott. He has both of those books, Dr. Gipp does, in his collection. And they can't tell their own son how to get saved. And they're messing around with bad stuff.
That's right.
And those are the guys that are going to tell, they could recognize the oldest and best. They're not saved themselves. So the whole point of this thing is I was absolutely flabbergasted and shocked that, quote, Christian scholarship had so betrayed us. I mean, Christian scholarship, huh? Really? We're just a Bible of the Month club, you know, there's another new one, and another new one, and another new one, and another new one, and another one. All these good godly scholars, you know, I'm not saying they're lost. I don't know if they are or not. Remember, I told them between them and God, I don't know. Hopefully they are. I'm not saying they're mean or evil or wicked or they go home at night and worship Satan or whatever. I don't believe that. But they're definitely being pawns, being used by the devil to make another one, and another one, and another one, and another one, and another one. And it's endless. There's no end to it on how many modern Bibles come out. But the one thing they all have in common is they will trace themselves back to the work of Westcott and Hoare and Sinaiticus Vaticanus manuscripts. There's only two lines of Bible, pure and corrupt.
That's right.
That's it.
All right.
Man, there's like 400 of these things. Yeah, I know, but it came from corrupt lineage. It does matter. It does matter where your Bible came from. Because like I said, Christians have been fooled. And they, you know, they're not meaning to be fooled. They don't want to be fooled or whatever. That's why any good preacher will tell you, look, you know that Paul rose people from the dead in his preaching. Yes, he did. It's in the Bible. Remember that guy that falls out the window? He's up there. He preached all night long. And the kid fell asleep in the window and fell out, hit the ground. They went outside. The kid's dead. Paul raised him back alive again. And you know what the people in Berea did when Paul came to town and preached in their church?
Wrong.
Those people of Berea went home and said, man, I'm going to check that out. Where's that at? New World Translation. Boy, the JW Bible right there. Keep my hands off that one. But anyway, I'll just grab one of these just for illustration. Just grab one. What was Paul saying? He was preaching. What? Where's that at? The folks in Berea were more noble than those folks in Thessalonica, for they searched the scriptures daily to see whether those things he was teaching was so. That is the mark, and that's the name of... This morning, my Sunday school class met without me. It's called the Berean Sunday School Class. That's the name of our group. Because, I mean, each of the groups, Jolly Seniors, there's some... The Amen, you know, the guys that are kind of... You know, there's different groups, the Ladies Group, the Morning Glories, or whatever they're called. They got all these different names of our Sunday school classes. Mine's the Berean Class, by design. I didn't necessarily pick that. I didn't force it on them. But they said, well, man, the way you make us go look and want us to go look and want us to go check that thing out, you go look it up yourself and you go see. That's exactly what they did in the Bible. Any good preacher has no problem with you. He would love you to run home.
Amen.
And say, where's that thing? Where's that text he was preaching at this morning? I'm going to go read that chapter myself and see. See if he's not, you know. You check everybody. You have to. You have to. There's so much deception out there in the world today. You've got to check every preaching you hear, thing on the internet. Oh, there's a book in Walmart, you know, 28 Minutes in Hell or whatever, you know, whatever, whatever. Just check it. Check it out. Check it out. Check it out. Check it out. I do it the military way. I'm a soul SWAT guy. We go in, I got my machine gun right here, MP5, and we're going in at the low ready, boy. I mean, we're checking. I'm on guard. When I'm listening, reading a book, reading some other author, I don't know this guy yet, I am on guard, boy. I'm going in, and we're going in nice and careful. careful. I'm using a metaphor there, analogy, if you will. That was my job. But we go in with our heads up and our eyes open, boy. We're not zeroed in. We're looking all over the place. Gun's down. You don't pick it up unless you're going to use it. And so it's down and we're going in. But I'm on guard. In firearm school, they call that condition yellow. You don't condition white, yellow, red, orange, and red. Jeff Cooper, gun sight, and all the schools, shooting and stuff. Be aware of your surroundings. Girls coming out of the mall, you know. Girls disappear coming out of malls like that. She was in our church, brother. The one that got beat with the shovel. She was in our church. Came back just recently for a funeral or something. Yeah, it was for a funeral. Just a couple weeks ago, she came back to town. She moved to. You know, was leaving work. She worked at the mall. I'm talking about Brittany Marcel. She was in our church, got beaten. Almost killed her. Mom come home at lunch, guy's beating her to death in her kitchen. She worked at the mall. But she wasn't aware of her surroundings when she came out. I'm trying to teach you to be on guard, ladies. Nothing else. That was a nice little warning. There's plenty of time to look at your phone. You can do it in your car, it's all locked up, or you're at home or wherever. But don't be buried with your head in the phone when you're walking around. And as a Christian, you need to know some things. The devil has evil intent for you.
That's right.
And would just as soon slip that Bible out of your hand and slip something else in it that's not a Bible. And have Jesus lying to you. Who would make a Bible that has Jesus lying?
Come on.
That was a great verse, brother. Great verse. You don't want that. Let me close exactly on time.